Well, I'm excited to be here on Sunday morning. Get to bring another message from God. I've been praying this week. As I pray, usually before I speak, hopefully before I speak, I pray that I would bring God's word and not my own. But this week was a fun week studying this passage because I found myself in this passage. You ever read the Word of God and you're like, wow, God, like you knew exactly where I was at today.
Yeah.
You know exactly what I was going through to this moment. And there's another time where I think, I would say probably this week, this Word, everybody in the room will see themselves in this. And so this is not one of those sermons where we'll say, oh, it's for the other person. But I really think we will all find ourselves in this passage of Scripture today. We're in James chapter 4. We're getting closer to the end of our messages in James. And I'm excited that God's going to continue to speak to us through our next series. But it's important that God is speaking to us now here in James. So we're at James chapter 4, and we're starting in verse 13 today. I've been praying for grace, because I know that I need God to help me speak this, because I'm going to be speaking things, and I want to be hearing it for myself too.
Yes.
So let's read this morning James chapter 4, and we're going to start in verse 13. It says this: Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this city or that city, spend a year there, and carry on business and make money. Why? You do not know even what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. Let's pray that we receive the word of God this morning. Father, we are thankful for the environment of worship that we have this morning, that your presence was here. And Father, we ask that you would continue, Father, to speak to us. I pray that our ears would be open, that our hearts would be open to receive the words that you would have for us today. Father, we know that it is wise to plan, but Father, Lord, I pray that in our planning we would not forget you. But Father, we are in desperate need of all of who you are. God, I pray that that word, Father, would be implanted in our lives, and Father, it would produce fruit that would remain in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So I see in this we have this desire, and I have a desire myself to plan. Anybody like to plan? I enjoy planning things out. I got some, just last week, Pastor and I were planning for some the summer events and the summer series and what's going to be happening in the church. It's a good thing. The Bible talks about also that it's a good thing to find wise counsel, right? To think about things and to think. But then I see here this verse 13 gets to me. Now listen, you say today or tomorrow we'll go to this city and spend a year there and carry on business and make some money. I said it's a good thing to make some money, right? It's a good thing to go and to have some plans that we would be able to prosper and bring prosperity in my life. And I'm kind of puzzled by James a little bit because, you know, last week we're talking about murder and adultery and all these kind of like sins that I think in this room would be like, of course that's a sin. Like there's no, you know, nobody has to convince me murdering is a sin, right? And then this week it says, well, plan. You can plan and be sinning. I said, wow, James, you're like really getting at me. And so it says here, instead, in verse 15, it says, instead, we should say, if the Lord wills. I said, okay, so all I need to do is add a little Christian cliche to my planning and everything is good, right? Did anybody do that? You said, okay, I'll just add this Christian cliche. Okay, if it's God's will. I remember getting so mad. There were some things in my life I was praying through, you know, and believing God for, and somebody would pray this amazing faith-filled prayer, and then at the end of the prayer, anybody have it? And they say, if it's God's will.
Yeah.
And I said, wait a second, do you believe what you just prayed over my life or not? Like, what is this? Do you want this for me? I don't believe James is talking to us this morning and telling us just to add a Christian cliche to our planning or to our prayers. But actually, what James is doing here is accusing us of doing something far greater, far worse. He's accusing us of making a human attempt at omnipotence.
Yes.
Being all-knowing, being all-powerful. And he's accusing us of making a divine power grab. And I say, oh man, maybe I identify with this. And he says here, we're going to find today two reasons why we shouldn't do this, why we shouldn't make these plans, or maybe some corrections in our planning. So first, let's look at verse 14. He says, we make plans, yet, verse 14 says, we do not even know what will happen tomorrow. Yeah. I said, oh my. You know, this year has been fun, because at the beginning of the year, Rachel and I, I've mentioned a few times, get to celebrate 10 years on the 19th, two more weeks, yeah. Like really good close. And somebody blessed us with a vacation trip. So I am guilty this whole year of thinking, I can't wait to May 19th, because I know I'm going to have this week in Mexico. I've been waiting for it, I've been looking for it, I've been planning for this one. I find myself on Google, like, searching different, you know, things about what we can do while we're down there, all this kind of time. But it says that you don't even know what tomorrow brings.
That's right.
So repeat with me. I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know.
I don't know.
I'm a finite and limited being.
Yes.
Finite and limited being.
Sounds like a cult or something in here, right? No, no. It's truth. We have to get into it. I don't know what tomorrow will bring. I am a finite. I don't know the beginning from the end. I don't know the future. I don't know how it all plays. I don't know these things. And you may ask, well, how does this sound like good news? We're going to get to that. It's good news that we're finite. It's good news that we don't know what tomorrow is. But when we're planning, here James talked about this, they're planning to do business and going to this other place that they think they're going to be able to control the outcome when they get there. We're going to go to this place, and we're going to make a profit, as if they have control of these things in their life. It's good news that we have limits on our lives. And we need to learn to lean into our limits and our lack of knowledge. You're like, Andrew, this seems opposite. I don't know, I was struggling with this week. I said, this seems opposite of how I do things. But we can lean into our limits and our lack of knowledge. Because when we lean into this, owning our lack of knowledge sets us on a course towards freedom.
Yes.
Talking about freedom this morning. Sing about freedom. I don't know if Mommy knew what my notes were going to say, but leaning into our lack of knowledge, leaning into our limits, is our path towards freedom. Most of it today, we have a hard time because technology has subverted our limits that God has put on us. You know, now all of a sudden, my phone at least helps me kind of think that I can be all present. I can be anywhere at any time, right? Facebook is really good at that. Social media, I can know what's going on the East Coast, West Coast, around the world. I got friends all over the place. I feel like my technology sometimes subverts the limits that God actually puts on me. Sometimes our technology, I have to be honest with you, sometimes my technology is me trying to be omnipresent or all-knowing. Google is great, because I can at any moment look up at Google, and Google will tell me a fact about this or that, right? You know, which is something even playing this week was the NFL draft. And so, you know, Green Bay Packers were picking different people. And I was like, all right, Google search, who's this person? You know, and all right, now I know who he is. Now I think that I can manage a football team because I know his stats. You know, he's a good pick or a bad pick, right? Trying to give me to think. It's almost as if it's a modern day Tower of Babel, some of our technology. We're trying to go beyond the limits that God has set on us. Technology bad? No, I don't think I'll get rid of my iPhone. But again, we're looking at this. Why is James talking about what is underneath this planning? We got to get underneath. What's going on? And James will tell us here shortly what's going on underneath our good planning. So the second reason, first reason why we it's hard for us to plan, or wrong for us to plan, is why we don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. And secondly, it says in verse 14, the second part of verse 14, it says, what is your life but a mist? I said, man, is really hard for me to think about. What is my life but a mist and time? The timeline of life, the time of the human time. Now, what is our life but a mist, but a second? We have a Christian understanding. Again, this is our foundation, our Christian understanding, our purpose, our life goal. It's found, again, in Genesis 1 and in Genesis 3. This kind of starts the framework of where we as believers launch our whole life, our purpose, and what we do in life. But Genesis 1 is that we were made in God's image. We bear His likeness. Our purpose is to find value and identity and purpose in that we were made in the image of God. And so we can look at God, and we say this often because we want to get this deep inside of us, that in Genesis 1, we are made in the image of God. So our purpose, when we find our identity, when we find what we should do, when we find our value in that. We were created in His image. We have infinite value, but just a short time. So our purpose, what is our purpose? To act in the character of God, to move in the character of God, to show the character of God. We also know in the framework of that, though, is Genesis 3. We talk about the fall. The fall multiplied our limits. God said, this is who you are, this is what we're meant to be, this is what you can do. And all of a sudden, the fall now says, no, my limits are boundless. I can go wherever I want. I can do whatever I want. It gave us desires to overcome the limits that God had put on us. These limits were set for us for a purpose, so that we would be in a dependent relationship with God. So we have a hard time with limits and a hard time with control. I've confessed a few times. Actually, when I was a kid, I loved rules. I loved it because it told me where my boundaries were. I'm like, cool, I can play as much as I want inside of this thing. But our sin nature, our fallen nature, it wants us to overcome the limits that God put on us, so that we would be in control, that we would get glory, so that we would have more knowledge. But all these things are meant for God. See, we are human, we're not divine. We are God ourselves, we are human. We are created, we're not the creator. We're present, we're not omnipresent. We're in this room, we don't know what's going on at home right now.
That's right.
Sometimes I can create fear, we'll talk about that in a moment. We are knowing, but not all-knowing. We are responsible, but not sovereign. And so sometimes I have this idea, though, is that I have these good thoughts about myself. Like, well, but I am a good planner, but I have done good creative things. Yeah, but I am good at this, or God has given me these talents. And so the thought is, instead of boasting, which we'll talk about here, instead of being prideful in ourselves, that should turn us into more worship to who God is. Because if these things are represented in my life so well, how much more are they represented in an omnipotent, all-great, all-knowing God?
Yeah, come on.
So if I have the ability to plan, how much more then does God have the ability to plan? And can I lean into His greatness? If I'm good at loving and caring for the poor and for those who are me, how much more then does God, who created me, have these characteristics represented in Him? So instead of turning into pride and boasting of my ability to create these things or to do these things, I turn into worship. God, you are that much greater than the things that are represented in my life. It's a different attitude in who we are. It's a different heart. Most of our frustrations come in our unwillingness to be human, to have limits. See, we aren't content with being dependent on God. Amen. Our relationship is based on our dependency on Him. Mm-hmm. Instead of looking up in worship, we look up in envy. We look up in jealousy. We want to be like Him. But He says, you're not. Right. Allow me to be me. Allow God to be God. And be satisfied with the limits, the giftedness that I've given to you. Says it continues on here, verse 14. You're a mist, but it says right before there, what is your life? Question we all have to wrestle with. What is my life? It's but a mist. It's valuable. It's hugely valuable. It's hugely important. It has purpose. It's but a mist. It's short. And if we're not a follower of Jesus, then we have to ask, where do we derive our meaning from? Where do we derive this desire for production and to be successful? Where does this come from? The Christian, we back to Christ in our image, that we are bearers of God. But we have to be honest, sometimes we struggle with this. So verse 15 gives us the instead. What should we do? Here's some reason why we shouldn't, right? We shouldn't because we know that we don't know tomorrow. We shouldn't because life is short and God is all in control. And verse 15 says, this is what you should do instead. Instead, verse 15, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. I hate Christian cliches. Have I said that already a few times? I mean, when I don't like it when I just have an adage, and they're just like an adage, and it doesn't really mean anything. When I say cliches, I'm saying it's just words that we're adding on. But it's not a heart. So James, again, is not saying add this Christian cliche. It's not just adding the clause. That's not the point here. It's a point of a conviction point at the level of our heart, of the sovereignty of God in all things. So in my heart, I am convinced. I am convicted. As Pastor said, I believe God is sovereign. God is in control. God is who he said he is. God is great. God is powerful. God is all-knowing. He is these things. I believe this in my heart. And at that point, at the heart conviction, then I can say, if it is the Lord's will. Mm-hmm. And I say that from a point of conviction, not just because, okay, I know I should add this to what I'm saying more than that. James is not telling us not to plan. The Bible, again, is not against plan. It talks about getting wise counsel, to look for tomorrow. It talks about that the word is God is for our footsteps, and wherever we are led, the Lord leads our footsteps, right? There's good things in planning. There's good things in seeking counsel. However, we have to examine the thing that's underneath our planning. Where is our heart at? Do we truly trust that the Lord is in control of these things? Or are we just practicing atheism? We're just going about our life, doing our plans, and thinking that we're doing great and good things without consulting the one that's awesomely great and in control. Correct me, Lord, at my heart level. Nothing in the future happens unless the Lord wills it. So that's where the heart of this comes. That's where James is getting it. Nothing in the future happens unless the Lord wills it. Or I go on my own and make a mistake, and then I get my own way, right? But nothing in the future happens unless the Lord wills it. And why should we say this? Why should we have this in our vocabulary? Why should we add this? Why is James telling, add this to your what you're planning? Why we should say it? Because it's true. It's true. The reason why we should say, if the Lord wills it, is because it's true. That if he doesn't will it, it won't happen. Secondly, it reminds us that we are not God. Yeah. When I'm planning things out and thinking about the future things for the church or future things even for my family, as we're talking about adoption and these things and where God is taking us in the future, I need to remind myself to say, if it's the Lord's will. If the Lord wills it, because it reminds me I'm not God. It's a practice of reminding myself, I'm not God. It bears witness, thirdly, why should we say that? It's because it bears witness to the fact that we are not God. So it reminds us that it bears witness. It bears witness to our spirit. God, you're in control. And fourthly, it's because it's a practicing of liturgy. I don't know how many of you guys played sports, or maybe you played instruments growing up. Maybe you're still an instrumentalist or love to play sports. But you know that I knew as an athlete, the more that I did something, the better I got at it, right? If for soccer season, if I didn't spend my off season, you know, shooting penalty kicks and getting my aim correct, or during my time during track season, if I wasn't running on the off season, I knew, hey, I had to start all over again. But the more that I did it, the repetition of what I was doing, I got better at it. Why should we be continuing to say these things? Because the more we say it, the more it gets into our heart, the more we believe it.
That's right.
So sometimes if I start with, I know it's true, but I'm having a hard time believing it. I know it's true, God, if you don't will it, it won't happen. But sometimes I don't believe it. So I have to get into my heart that I believe it. So I practice by saying it. God, it's your will. Lord, if it's your will. Lord, if it's your will. It's your will. And then as I know it, it gets into my heart, it gets into my belief system. Because ultimately, we continue on here, this wrong thing about planning is, well, ultimately, a worship issue. Verse 16, look at that. As it is, our planning as it is, before we declare our dependence on God, before we practice this, as it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. The sin loves to turn ourselves inward. We love to be excited about ourselves. Sin loves to get our attention off of the one that we worship and onto ourselves. I love Martin Luther. He has a quote here, and if you don't mind, I want to read a little bit of it. But Martin Luther, it's a quote about how the sin and sin's effect on us. It says this: our nature, by corruption of the first sin, being so deeply curved in on itself that it not only bends the best gifts of God towards itself and enjoys them, as it is plain in the works, righteous and hypocrite, or rather, even uses God himself in order to attain these good gifts. But it also fails to realize that it so wickedly, curved, and viciously seeks all things, even God, for its own sake. This is our habit of sin. If we turn everything inward, we turn even God himself inward, the gifts that he's given us, inward to how can I benefit myself? How can I boast myself? How can I increase myself? I said earlier that sometimes we have an envy of God. We want to be all knowing like God is. We put ourselves on that kind of threshold. Every good thing, including God himself, is sin ends up turning it into a means in which I can be satisfied. God, instead of being transcendent, somebody that we worship, somebody that we desire, and somebody that we can come in Sunday morning and get all excited about her in our home and get all excited about who he is and have a life full of worship every day. Instead of him being some transcendent being that we worship, all of a sudden he becomes a functional being. So we worship him so much as he gives us what we want. I'll worship you for tomorrow because I know that I want to succeed. And God, if I succeed, then I'll worship you. God, if you bless this plan, then I'll come to you. If you bless my family, if everything in my life is going great, then I want to praise you, God, because you're so good. But actually, the power of our praise is found in the midst of the time that we say, hey, I am lacking and I need you. I'm lacking and I need you. And then the praise becomes real in our life. Then the worship in our life becomes real because, you know, I'm sorry, I am guilty of making God look bigger than what we have in our everyday life because he is so much bigger. And when our mind changes to see how great and how glorious and how wonderful he is, our worship changes, our life changes, the way our attitude of our heart, the way we plan, and we're talking about today specifically planning, but everything in our life changes. When we get a bigger view of who God is, if anything, we're guilty of making God smaller than what he is. And it's a sin at work in our lives. This is the root of the statement about the future. This is the root. That we think we can go about doing our own thing, making our own plans, and exclude the one that is all-knowing, that knows tomorrow, that knows the future, that has control to change these things. I mentioned sometimes we feel that like we have become unconscious atheism that allows and causes our own will to be done. We're just going after, we're just doing life without even consulting the one who's in control of it.
Yes.
Everything good comes from above. So even statements like, I'm going to go to town and I want to make some money and then come back, it identifies with, it's all about me. It's this boastful thing. It's all, I'm going to go to this town, I want to make some money. It's all about you. It's all about what you want. It's all about what you need. You get to use people for your own profit. We get off of, if, when we get our attention off of who God is, then his creation also becomes for our use and for our benefit. Then we're using people around us to get this accessible future. We lower our sights from God, and we give it on people, and now we're trying to get from people what God has meant to give to us. Then we try to get it from ourselves, and we find then ourselves in the frustration because we can't get it from ourselves, we can't get it from other people, and we're frustrated because our relationship was meant to be dependent fully on who he was.
Yeah.
He created us again. He created us with limits for a purpose that we would depend on him. That was, he decided that that would be the best life for us. He knew the best life for us was for us to be a dependent people
Amen.
On him. Because we know he's limitless, even in our limits. Sometimes when we live out my life, I live out my life as if God doesn't exist in my real life. But he does. He wants to be involved in my decision about job. He wants to be involved in the decision about what child we're going to adopt this year. He wants to be involved in the decision about where I'm going to live and who my neighbors are going to be in. And even, I would say, Brittany and I, we were talking one day, you know, and we talked about, you know, sometimes it's crazy to think sometimes people even ask God, you know, where I should shop or what I should get or what I should wear. And I said, you know, that kind of stretches my faith sometimes. It stretches me to think that way. But that's how intimate God wants us to be. And I'll say, it's okay. I would challenge you. It's okay to pray those prayers. God, what would you will for me today?
Right.
How would you want me to love my children this day? How would you want me to treat my spouses? How would you want me to, and all these things are things that we do on a regular basis because we know we are competent. God gives us those abilities. But God, how much greater would my love be for my family if I depend on God? How would you want me to love my family? How would you want me to plan out my life? How would you want me to work? And where would you want me to? How would you want me to be at work today? How would you? Dependent on him. So we can go on our lives as if we know everything. We can cause the outcome by our behavior. That God doesn't even play a part of it at all. And there's two sides of this. One side is that it leads us to boasting. Because we've been so familiar with doing things and accomplishing things. But the other side of this is a culture in the U.S. and in our culture of a self-medicated. They're going after alcohol, they're going after drugs, they're taking pills and medicating and all that kind of stuff. Because then all of a sudden, the opposite side of this is the pressure that comes on me. So then I recognize, oh, I'm not able to do these things. Oh, I can't do them. And then we get on the side of depression and falling and failure and unpeace in my life and in fear that captures me, right? So one side of the coin is, hey, I can do it on my own and I want to be independent and I'm going to go after it and God, I don't need you. And the other side of it is now all of a sudden I'm in total fear because I can't do anything and all the pressure of the world's on me. And both of those are found in the same root. They're both rooted in that God doesn't play a role in my everyday life. The truth is that he does. So even whether I'm boasting about these things and I'm living all for myself, then I need to say, God, forgive me. Allow me to see that you are the one that actually controls all things, that you have my future in control. And the other side, if you're in the boat this morning, you say, man, the pressures of life are so weighing down on me. I'm full of fear and I'm full of anxiety. The other side of it is also to put our eyes on God and say, no, you aren't alone. You aren't doing this alone. Both sides, you're not doing it alone. God is with you and he's intricately wants to be intricately involved in our everyday life.
Yes. Amen.
Either side has a root of arrogance where you are at the center of the story. But Christ wants to be the center of our story.
Amen.
Christ wants to be the center of our story. Verse 17 says this, if anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin for them. We love to categorize sin. Like I said, we knew last week when we talked about adultery and murder and those kind of, we're like, all right, those are automatically sin. But it says here, it brings an even greater definition of sin. If anyone that knows good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it's sin for them. What is sin? Any thought or action or desire that redirects us away from Christ. Any thought, action, or desire that redirects us away from Christ, that redirects us away from the dependency on Him, that redirects us away from His story in our lives, that redirects anything that redirects us away from Christ is sin. And anything, and we know these things to do good, but we ought to do, and we don't do them, it's sin. So instead of our worship and our focus being how great He is, it gets focused on His creation, and it changes everything about us because we seek after our own desires. It becomes sin. The person that plans this way, the way that James described, they don't have room for Jesus in their plans. Anything James says, make room for Jesus. He's the best thing for your plans. He's the best thing for your life. It's Jesus. We have a deep need for somebody else. We're created that way. We're created with these motives. We have a deep need for somebody else. He is God. But oftentimes we're blinded by our own success and it becomes our default mode. So we're, like I said, I'm good at these things. I planned things out and it turned out good. Because of our default mode, because we never really needed God. God gave me the gifts, and so like I just used my gifts and I got these results. It becomes easier for us to move away from God because of the success that we have in our lives. It becomes a temptation for us. It becomes a temptation to get my... whenever something goes good in my life and I forget or I lose sight of who God is and it goes good, it kind of convinces me that I can do this. Yeah, anything that gets our eyes off of Christ is a temptation. The status quo. Hey, I'm doing all right in my life. It's a temptation to success. Things normally working out the way that we expect them to, it's a temptation not to lean on Christ. We have to focus our mind on Him. This is what James is talking about. Not adding a Christian cliche. But James is encouraging us, and this morning the message is encouraging us to reorient ourselves on God, on who He is. He gave us limits so that we can be dependent on Him. He knows that the best position for our lives is a life lived out in dependency on His greatness, on His ability. On His all-knowing. The good news is not, gosh, I have to depend on God. Man, I've got to, it's so burdensome to lean on Him. No, the good news is, I'm limited and I can lean on one who is able to see the future. I am limited and I have one that is able. I am limited and I have one that is all-knowing. Yeah, I am limited, but I have one who has heals all things. I have one, I'm limited, I can't restore things on my own, but I have one that can restore things on His own. I have one that can speak things into existence. I have one on my side. I'm dependent on one who is able. The best position for us to be in. It's good news. It's the fullest way to be human. It's to depend on God. To be outward oriented and not inward oriented. We should reason and we should get rid of our anxiety. If you have any arrogance in your life, pride in your life, anxiety in your life, it's because you've been trying to take position of God and He wants you to come back and say, I need you. Trying to be something we can't be causes this in our lives. Only God can be God. And we need Him. I'm going to invite Mom up to play this morning. There's a song that we used to sing. And, I know a different... I don't know about you, but... when I came to know the Lord, I was really young, and the songs, and somebody told me one time, the songs that you sang when you came to the Lord are songs that, like, mean a lot to you, right? You remember those songs, you're like, yeah, anytime somebody sings as a deer pants, you know, I'm like, oh, get excited, or shout to the Lord, I'm like, that song won't get old, because that was a song you used to sing, and I worship, and one of them was, I need you, Lord, more than yesterday, I need you, Lord. And I love praying a prayer like that. It's one, it's humiliating. Yes. It's humiliating to say, I need something. You know, I know, and Pastor was talking about being like a child. You know, those that have children around are mean, and children have no problem saying they need something. As a parent, and parents are here, do kids have a problem saying they need something? They're like, I need it. I want this now. I want it. Right? This morning, we have an opportunity to become childlike. But I love this, Pastor mentioned this, in our childlikeness, we can become mature. We don't understand it because it's backwards to our culture. But becoming like a child actually creates maturity in our life. So like a child, we're getting ready to come before God and say, I need you. We raised hands this morning and said we needed him. There are people this morning that said, yes, there's something going on in my life. I need God. See, I know you guys aren't afraid to admit it. But now we need to take the next step and say to God, come before God and say, God, I need you. God, I'm desperate for you. God, I can't do it on my own. If we're willing to get in that position like a child, come before the daughter and father who's good, who only gives good gifts, and say, God, I need you, I need you, I need you, I need you. And it really becomes the cry of our heart. It becomes conviction in our heart. God, I believe that I need you. And when I say it, God, I know that you can come through. When we get that in our heart, and a heart of it, we only will get him. There's nothing else. He won't give us anything else. He'll just give us him. And in our process of becoming like a child and saying, I need you, we actually mature. Because a mature Christian isn't one that has it all together. A mature Christian is one that knows his dependency on God. Why does a mature Christian pray and say, oh, I know this person, they pray a lot. They love the Lord. They pray a ton. Because they know they're dependent on him. I know as a Christian, he's really mature. He reads the Bible all the time. He's in the Word. He's memorizing things. Why is it? Because he knows he's dependent on God. He's become a child. But he's mature. So this morning, I want to extend an invitation to you. Come to the altar. Just say, God, I need you. I need you in my plan. I need you in my future. Maybe you have an issue in your life, a problem that you know, you understand, I can't do it on my own. You have all this, and it's falling out of you, like a person carrying too many groceries, and it's falling out everywhere. And you know, in your life, you've got all these things. Father says, come to me this morning. Give it to me. You need me. That's what he's saying this morning. You need me. You need God. Let's pray this morning. If you, I don't want to go on feelings. If you need to respond this morning. Come down. Tell God you need it. Let's pray. Father, as we respond to the message today, Father, I pray that you would do a heart change in us. Father, we thank you for the gifts that you've given us, but Father, we also thank you for the limits that you've given us in our lives. And Father, today our understanding has been increased to know that our limits have been given to us so that we can be dependent on you. Father, the best way to live a human life is to live it dependent on you. So this morning as we respond, as we come to the altar, and we say and we cry out to you, God, I need you. Lord, I need you. I need you today more than I did yesterday. I need you, God. Father, I pray for every individual here, God, that you will come through in a way only you can. Father, that you would bear your character upon them. Father, you would bear your ability, your omnipresence, your all-knowing, your all-powerful, your nature would come to bear on who they are. And Father, it would result in a life of worship, a life of dependency on you. God, change our hearts this morning. Now, if you're here this morning, you need to respond. Come to the altar. Come on down. Come on down. Let's declare our dependency on God. If you're here this morning, you say, yes, I need God more in my life. Come on down. All it's going to take is one person, and the rest of you are going to respond. And you be the first person down. It's all right. It's okay. It's okay to be humble before the Lord. It's okay to be humble. humiliated before the Lord, to become a child so that we can gain maturity.
Thank you.